my God. Thank goodness they revealed that Miss Martian is a white Martian. Because the whole episode, I was like, how am I not going to tell everybody in my review? I'm so excited to talk about it. I felt like that character that Kristen Wiig did on Saturday Night Live for a while. I never really got that character until watching this episode of Supergirl. Because I, too, was like, oh my goodness. Every time they like dropped a breadcrumb, I was like, she's a white Martian. She's a white Martian. Oh, come on, let's talk about it. So again, I'm so glad that they revealed that at the end of the episode. You know, the whole time that, you know, John Jones was like, I forgive you, or we can still be friends. I was like, man, you better tell him now, Megan. But then it's so bad to be a white Martian considering what happened on Mars and what the white Martians did to the green Martians. I can understand why she's still holding back. But I think that, you know, it's interesting. I think that this version of Miss Martian is a real disappointment to anyone who watches, or who watched, because unfortunately it's no longer on. But anybody who watched Young Justice, this is not the Miss Martian that everyone fell in love with and why everyone was excited to see her on Supergirl. But I can understand not wanting to do that version of the character because it might be a little bit too close to Kara, right? I mean, she's a little bit of a Miss Martian herself. But I think that the substitute they have, where she was a prison guard at the worst prison camp, you know, that the white Martians had, and, you know, she defied orders, you know, it's the old, you know, for lack of a better comparison, you know, the Nazi soldier who won't, you know, who won't go through with orders, right? But did Miss Martian ever go through with orders, or was this just a change she decided to make one day? It's going to be intense, and I would like to know more about what happened on Mars, and this is opens the door to that, so I'll take that over the Miss Martian from Young Justice, because again, that would pull back, I think, from Supergirl, but I love it so much! I guess, you know, things happen pretty fast on this show, so she'll probably tell him pretty soon, probably this season, and that's gonna be a really good episode. So I have to say, speaking of good episodes, this was a spectacular episode. This was, I dare say, a perfect episode. It was so well constructed. And that's why the second thing that I have to say, you know, that I think that's worth talking about in my list of top five things for this episode is the writing. Just even the title, Survivors. Because last night was Halloween, although I appreciated the Halloween nod in the bar. I watched this episode today on my desktop, and they had the title continuously up while I was watching. And I was like, ah, yes, Survivors, great title, because they did a really good job having, you know, the parallel storylines of Megan and John Jones versus Kara and Mon-El. I think they did a great job with Roulette and her commentary on, you know, immigration, and saying, you know, and I think to some degree truthfully, that people cared more about the dogs that Michael Vick had fighting each other than aliens. I thought it was like, ooh, good topical comparison, Roulette. You did go to school. And also, I hope the DEO will eventually go here, but I thought that really showed that the DEO, instead of just making inspiring speeches at a crime, at a crime scene when they're about to arrest Roulette, that perhaps they should consider setting up an assistance program, not just hunt aliens down to arrest them, but to try and rehabilitate them and help them, you know, fit into society instead of, you know, it's a little bit like when you're out of, you know, prison, you know, you can't just be like, good luck. You know, you have to realize that there are problems. And even for the aliens who haven't done anything wrong, they also need to be, settled into Earth, just as Kara is going to do with Mon-El. Now, we'll get to Mon-El in just a moment, but the next thing, I think a better transition, is that this was a very well-written episode, and I think everything they did with the DEO was so perfect that it proved they don't need CatCo, especially if you're not going to have Cat Grant. I mean, I felt that the whole journalism thing was really bad. I mean, I was like, do I have to really sit here while Kara takes remedial journalism classes? Like, has she ever read a news story? I didn't understand how she couldn't get what Snapper, you know, the lessons that Snapper Kara was teaching her already. I mean, she should just be soaking these up, having worked at CatCo for some time. I would also say, though, that I thought that it was ridiculous that Snapper Kara wanted her to do all that legwork before she got an approval for the story. I would have been like, look, Snapper, that's a lot of work. And I'm just trying to make sure that you think this is something you are going to, you know, that you think is worth putting in the paper or whatever, wherever Catco runs stories. I don't think they've really made that clear, actually. You know, I'd be like, because I thought when the show started, because all those TV screens behind Cat, that it was like a news or a web network, right? So I don't know what they're publishing. But, you know, it's like you're supposed to get the green light to pursue it. You know, like, okay, I think you might have something there. Keep going with it. Or I will never publish that. Don't waste your time, right? I mean, I guess Snapper Carr cares that little about her, but that's what I would say there. But also the other problem beyond it being like remedial journalism is that, come on, it's Clark Kent meets Pete Parker. I think that it's beneath Supergirl to so obviously copy other characters, male characters, no less. I don't think that would make it even, I think if she was copying female characters, it wouldn't make it any better. It's just kind of sad. And also, though, I also thought even more so with this, that Snapper's so inconsistent. I'd be like, hey, Snapper, you insisted I get a source, but I could have just, I mean, she even seemed like she was making it up when she was telling him. How does he know that Supergirl is her source? You'd think she'd have to do the whole John Jones pretending to be Supergirl thing again, like she did with Cat Grant, to prove that they were two separate people. You know, I mean, the way she's doing it, I'd either be like, you're Supergirl, which I easily figured out, or you're lying. I liked the Reddit comment, though. This isn't Reddit, you need a source, because there's such a problem with fake news these days in the real world. But, you know, I would think that even though you don't have to give the source away to the world, potentially, or, you know, or you don't have to prove it to your readers, I would think that, you know, especially with somebody so new like Kara, who needed to take remedial journalism, I'd be like, prove it that Supergirl's your source. I think it would have been more, if she had been more believable if she said Maggie Sawyer or, you know, her sister Alex. I think that would have been an easier way to go and a better way to prove it. But anyway, I digress. So the next thing I wanted to talk about was Mon-El. Everything I dislike about Tyler Hoechlin's Superman, I love about Chris Wood's Mon-El. I think this guy is super charismatic. And while I think Tyler Hoechlin's a little wooden in his acting, although to be fair, I haven't seen him on Teen Wolf, and maybe that's his version of how Superman would act. I don't know. But I think Mon-El is fantastic. I think he's really likable. I love the idea of Supergirl fulfilling her promise to her parents to train Kal-El and instead doing it with a different L, Mon-El. I thought that was great. But I have to say, though, on a side note, I bet she's really bad at it, because Supergirl tends to be bad at pretty much everything. But she's really bad at organizational, you know, her organizational skills are lacking, and I also think her leadership skills are lacking. If Supergirl's ever a leader, it's by example. I think she's not one to run other people or tell them what to do, but maybe that'll be the point. We'll see her do, she'll be like, whoo, it's a good thing that somebody else trained Kal-El, because I would have messed him up bad. I do like also the contrast of Daxon versus Krypton, the party school versus, you know, the Ivy, it would seem. I think that's really funny. I think they're doing a great job with that. And to Chris Woods' credit, he never makes Mon-El seem like slimy, like a jerk, right? Like, he's able to have the party aspects, you know, he reminds me a little bit of Ryan Reynolds, actually. You know, the party aspects, the jokes, without seeming like he's, like, you know, a jerk and you wouldn't like him, right? So I think that's really great. Now, somebody tweeted me and they're like, oh, he had such chemistry with Winn. And I was like, are you kidding me? But when I watched the show for myself, well, first of all, Jeremy Jordan, that's all on him, because he plays Winn as gay for some reason. Although Jeremy Jordan in real life is not gay. So I don't know what's going on there. And also I'd be like, you can't have Winn flip. You can't have Alex flip. We'll talk about Alex in just a second. What's going on here? You know, Supergirl casting. I know that some of you would be like, woohoo. But I think we have to, you know, you have to slow it down a little bit. But I do think that it's believable, in my opinion, that Mon-El could maybe like anyone. I could see that being introduced, because he does come from this, you know, no holds barred party planet, where it would seem like they wouldn't be such sticklers for, you know, strict rules of sexuality. And I also thought that if he had a vibe with anybody in terms of flirtation, it was the prince. Although I'm sure those of you who don't like the idea of Stucky are like, they're just friends, damn it, Grace, what the hell? Although, you know, I think, I don't know, I would imagine that, I don't know, there just seemed to be a little bit of a wistfulness, you know, I guess the prince was about to die, but still. All right, so finally, we got to talk about Alex and Maggie, whose relationship or their flirtation continued this week. After my initial anger has settled down after losing Alex, I really don't like that character. I don't like it going down that route. And as some of you pointed, as for reasons I explained last week, and as some of you pointed out, she liked Maxwell Lord last season. She said a flirtatious remark about Superman this season. They just, you know, it seemingly has come out of nowhere. And you would think that maybe that's the point. Maybe that's the point they're trying to make, that you don't know who you're going to fall in love with. But I think that since Alex doesn't seem at all surprised by the situation, that's not reading true to me either. But the relationship itself is working for me this week. And I think that's totally thanks to the actress Floriana Lima, who plays Maggie Sawyer, who's doing a very good job in selling this. I think she makes Maggie Sawyer incredibly charismatic and more than just this flirtation with Alex, right? And I think Maggie Sawyer knows what she's doing, right? I mean, they didn't have to hold hands going in there. I was like, well played, Maggie Sawyer. But also very believable as a policewoman, a very good policewoman, no less. So I really, a detective, actually. My apologies. So I think that's really good. And I think that, you know, I'm starting to come around to it. And I think that at least it's being handled tastefully, even though I don't like the idea of doing that with the Alex character. I would have, again, preferred to just bring Kate Kane in and just have Maggie Sawyer be a gay character, a lesbian character on her own. And, you know, there's no need to pursue it with another character that already existed. Although I have to say, finally, Alex, stop embarrassing yourself. This is twice that she's asked Maggie Sawyer to do something, and twice she's been shot down. So Alex, you gotta just hang back and leave it up to Maggie Sawyer. And that's advice to anyone in any relationship, no matter who you're pursuing. Don't pursue too hard. It just makes you look bad. I think, you know, I don't blame her for trying the second time, because maybe the first time it seemed just like friends. But, you know, after two, you can't go for a third one. It's just too bad. All right, so I thought it was a great episode. I loved it so much, and I can't wait for next week's episode. All right, I look forward to continuing the conversation about the show down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.